Welcome. My name is Dr. Tom Daly. I'm the Chief of Pulmonary Medicine and Medical Director of our Sleep Apnea Management Program here at Kaiser Permanente Santa Clara. The purpose of this video is to provide you with information and guide you to make your own personal decisions regarding your future health outcomes. In this video, I will define snoring, define obstructive sleep apnea, list the signs and symptoms of obstructive sleep apnea, discuss possible risk factors for this condition, explain how the condition is tested and diagnosed, and mention the various treatments available to you, including 5 important lifestyle changes you can make that reduce the incidence of sleep apnea. Let's go ahead and get started. Snoring is noisy breathing while sleeping. During sleep, our respiratory structures vibrate and may become obstructed, causing that snoring sound. The sound most often comes from the soft palate and the base of the tongue. As you fall asleep, all those muscles around the throat area begin to relax. In fact, every muscle in your body relaxes. Your arms go limp, your legs go limp, and the airway muscles in the back of your throat go limp as well. This relaxation contributes to snoring. That area narrows. Snoring is very similar to whistling. Anytime air moves through a small opening, like one's lips, the air's speed increases, causes noise. Air moving through the lips is whistling. Air moving through the back of the throat, the exact same thing is happening in the back of your throat, and this produces that snoring sound. Temporary conditions such as allergies, head colds, sore throats, excess alcohol consumption are common causes of occasional snoring that comes now and then. This type of occasional snoring may be disruptive. Usually it's not a sign or a cause of concern. Chronic snoring, however, can be a symptom of something far more serious. It's thought that 2/3 of chronic snorers have obstructive sleep apnea. The good news is snoring by itself is not dangerous. In fact, snoring is actually a sign that you are still breathing. The true concern is that having snoring can be a sign of obstructive sleep apnea. Obstructive sleep apnea is a type of sleep disorder characterized by pauses in breathing or instances of shallow or infrequent breathing while sleeping. Each pause in breathing is called an apnea. This can last from as little as 10 seconds to several minutes. Typically, normal breathing restarts, sometimes with a loud snort or choking sound. Consequently, obstructive sleep apnea usually becomes a chronic, ongoing condition that disrupts your sleep. When snoring, your sleep may become interrupted, but snoring does not always equal obstructive sleep apnea. As mentioned earlier, snoring is a sign that you're still breathing, delivering oxygen to your body. But again, 2/3 of those who snore also have obstructive sleep apnea. Unlike snoring, obstructive sleep apnea has the potential to contribute to life-threatening conditions. Obstructive sleep apnea requires medical attention. Some of the health risks associated with obstructive sleep apnea include having a heart attack, a stroke, irregular heartbeat, high blood pressure, heart disease, decreased libido. In addition, obstructive sleep apnea can cause daytime drowsiness that can result in automobile accidents and lost productivity at work. There are several risk factors that contribute to obstructive sleep apnea. First, an anatomical abnormality, the nose, the throat, such as enlarged tonsils or adenoids, nasal polyps, deviated septums, can contribute to exaggerated narrowing of the throat. Normal aging leads to the relaxation of throat muscles. People age 65 and older are at greater risk. Heredity. If a family member of yours has obstructive sleep apnea, you're at much higher risk of having it yourself. Number four, excessive weight contributes to extra fatty tissue around the neck, which significantly increases the risk of developing obstructive sleep apnea. Number five, sleep position. Sleeping on your back, the same way it leads to increased snoring, can lead to obstructive sleep apnea. Number six, smoking. If you smoke, this increases your risk of many health concerns, including obstructive sleep apnea. Most people who have obstructive sleep apnea don't necessarily know that they have it, because it only occurs during sleep. Some symptoms can be mild, moderate, but some can be severe. A family member or loved one might be the first to notice signs of obstructive sleep apnea. Some of the most common symptoms are difficulty sleeping, constantly waking up in the middle of the night, unusual morning headaches, tiredness, fighting sleepiness during the day at work or while driving, high blood pressure, feeling irritable, depressed, or suddenly more moody than usual, dry mouth or sore throat when you wake up. You may have been told that you stop breathing when you're asleep by your partner. Few people have all of these symptoms, but any one symptom is enough to talk to your doctor about being tested for obstructive sleep apnea. How do we do this testing? A sleep study, sometimes called a polysomnogram, is a test that electrically transmits and records specific physical activities during sleep. The recordings become data that are analyzed by a qualified sleep specialist to determine whether or not you have a sleep disorder. This test will determine oxygen levels, breathing, heart rate, how many times you may stop breathing throughout the night, and how long that period is. This test is a home monitoring test. The advantages of home testing is that it allows you to sleep in the comfort of your own home, in your own bed, a more natural state. Our team of experts will show you how to use the equipment, customize it for you, so that you can take this home, sleep with it overnight in your own home, follow the directions for that particular night when you speak with our experts. The next morning, you'll need to bring the equipment back to us so that we can retrieve your results. If the outcome of the test shows that you do have obstructive sleep apnea, but it's mild, the first option may be again to address these five lifestyle changes before seeking alternative treatments. The first lifestyle change for mild sleep apnea and snoring is to lose some weight if you have excessive weight. As little as 10 pounds can make a difference. Not everybody with obstructive sleep apnea is overweight. If you're not overweight, losing weight is not going to help. But many patients with sleep apnea are overweight. If this is the case, losing weight can help decrease that deposition of fat around the windpipe, allow your heart to work less hard, decrease your risk for sleep apnea and therefore for heart disease and for stroke. Lifestyle change number two, teach yourself to not sleep on your back. You can use pillows to support your position. Another trick that actually sounds silly but is very effective is take any shirt that has a pocket in the front, put the shirt on backwards, and put a tennis ball in the pocket. What happens is whenever you roll on your back in your sleep, it's uncomfortable and it encourages you to roll on your side or your stomach. And it's not like you have to do this for the rest of your life. For most people, you do this for 3 or 4 weeks and you become a side sleeper. Lifestyle change number 3, avoiding alcohol or any sedative medication. Narcotics, sleeping pills, other medicines that can make you sleepy can all make mild sleep apnea worse. Of course, if you're taking any medicine that makes you groggy, you may ask for an alternative from your doctor. Don't just stop it. Talk with your doctor about this. But getting rid of anything that makes you groggy can help eliminate mild sleep apnea or snoring. Lifestyle change number 4. Completely clear your sinuses to the point of no drainage. A saline rinse can help you get rid of a sinus congestion. These are available over the counter. With these flush kits, one of the keys is, believe it or not, don't follow the directions on the kit. Most of them are marketed for a runny nose and teach you to flush in one nostril and out the other. The greatest effect is if you tip your head back and snort and actually flush it in the nostril, through the sinuses, down the throat, and spit it out of your mouth. Everybody gets a little gagging sensation the first time they do that, but as long as you do it every single day, within a week, you figure out how to hold your head, how to angle that flushing device, so the choking sensation goes away, you desensitize the throat. You can visit the kp.org, my doctor website, and find a video that demonstrates how to use that flush kit correctly. It can be a very effective tool. Lifestyle change number 5. If you smoke, you want to quit smoking. The combination of obstructive sleep apnea and smoking can cause all sorts of cardiovascular complications. Smoking lowers oxygen levels, irritates the upper airways, increases respiratory health problems. Obstructive sleep apnea can lead to stroke and heart disease, while smoking increases one's chance of contracting those same problems. Kaiser Permanente has various options to help you quit and to stay quit. These include personal classes, online tools, telephone appointments, wellness coaches, nicotine replacement therapies, a variety of options to help you succeed in quitting smoking. I've touched on 5 lifestyle changes that can help you decrease snoring and mild obstructive sleep apnea. Decrease weight, sleep on your side, clear sinuses regularly, eliminate alcohol and sedatives that make you groggy, and quit smoking. If you make these 5 lifestyle changes first, it can give you an opportunity to avoid any future need for treatment and possibly resolve snoring and mild sleep apnea altogether. Our recommendation is that you make these changes, but if you feel no improvement in 2 or 3 months, we probably need to retest you and see what's happening with your mild sleep apnea or snoring. If the outcome of the sleep test shows that you have significant sleep apnea, this means that your airway closing is significant, your oxygen level is affected. A normal oxygen level is anything in the 90% saturation range, 90s to 100. Anytime your oxygen level goes below 90%, we start to get worried. If you've got significant obstructive sleep apnea, we often need to prescribe continuous positive airway pressure. It's sometimes abbreviated as CPAP. This is equipment that is used to gently stent your airway open when you stop breathing while you sleep. This helps you breathe continually throughout the night. It addresses the problem of airway closure. As long as you breathe throughout the night, you get deep, restful sleep and you feel well in the morning. With CPAP, a nasal mask literally is placed over the nose and allows the machine to determine when you stop breathing and allows it to gently introduce positive airway pressure and reopen your airway throughout the night. It's important to know CPAP is a long-term treatment for those with significant obstructive sleep apnea. This is equipment that you would use long-term during your life. The good news is CPAP is extremely effective. We see over 95% success rates with proper use of this equipment. The downside is it can take time to get used to sleeping with this equipment, but once you start sleeping better, the less you notice that you're actually wearing a mask. In addition to testing each of you for obstructive sleep apnea, we're also going to be testing each of you for a second sleep condition called upper airway resistance syndrome. Upper airway resistance syndrome is actually very similar to obstructive sleep apnea. In upper airway resistance syndrome, just like in obstructive sleep apnea, people fall asleep, airway muscles relax, airway collapses, and oxygen levels start to drop. 98%, 97%, 96%, 95%, 94%. But in upper airway resistance syndrome, before the oxygen levels get terribly low, people wake up or go to a less deep level of sleep, and their airway opens up and they start breathing, and their oxygen level comes back. And then they start to get into deep, restful sleep, and the same process happens over and over again throughout the night. So patients with upper airway resistance syndrome never get terribly low oxygen levels, but they're exhausted during the day because no matter how many hours they sleep, they never get into deep, restful sleep. Someone with upper airway resistance syndrome might sleep 10, 12 hours a night and still feel tired during the day. The treatment is the same as with obstructive sleep apnea. If it's significant upper airway resistance syndrome, we use nasal CPAP. If it's mild or borderline, you might decide to try one or more of those five lifestyle changes and then come back in 3 or 4 months and be retested. I look forward to working with each of you at our session when we get together to go over your overnight sleep study results. At that session, we'll talk about the overnight testing that you're about to undertake. We'll review those results. We'll start those of you who require nasal CPAP on the equipment. But then we're also going to follow up with you in our drop-in clinic. And the drop-in clinic is important because even though we're going to give you the basics of how to use CPAP at our session when we get together, there are many other features that we want to share with you more than we could share in a single day. That's what's going to happen at the drop-in clinic. I look forward to seeing you and working with you soon. We've discussed a lot of information. It's normal if you feel a little overwhelmed or have new questions. Please be assured, we're going to help answer all of those questions and work with you every step of the way. Likewise, if your symptoms do not improve or you have any issues with the interventions we've discussed, please call the Sleep Apnea Clinic, 408-851-2558. Thank you for taking the time to view this video and for allowing us to be part of your care.